In this video, we're installing the modular wood system for joisted or battened floors. In this case, plumbing the system from above. There's a separate video that shows how to plumb the modular wood system from below a joisted floor. This is a tongue and groove product that combines 10mm pipe and floor deck. It has red lines printed on the surface to indicate where the integral pipe is located. They're standard size panels, so it's no problem combining them with standard TNG chipboard or plywood panels where necessary. There are panel variations available that are only partly fitted with heating pipe. You'll use these if you need to cut panels to size, without cutting through any pipe. By the way, you can cut these modular wood panels the same way as you would any chipboard or plywood panels. Some panels are piped at the tongue end and some at the grooved end. These are designed to face each other, as you'll see on the layout drawings which we normally prepare for you. These are for you to follow when you're laying the panels. In some areas of the room, you'll use plain panels, because underfloor heating shouldn't be installed under permanent fixtures such as kitchen cupboards or bathroom fixings. If you're going to be laying these over a joisted floor like this one, install insulation as required first. This will minimise the downward heat loss. Also, if it's a joisted floor, you'll need a crawling board to move around the room safely as you go through the early work stages, until you have some of the heating panels placed. You'll be laying the heating panels across the joist or battens, and leaving a 10mm expansion gap around the perimeter of the room. You must also leave an access bay between panel ends. It's the width of one bay between a pair of joists or battens. This is where the panels will be connected up. You'll also need to notch the tops of the joists or battens, so that the pipe tails from the panels can sit comfortably as they're taken into the access bay. The first panel should be placed in a corner of the room with the grooved edges next to the wall. When you reach the other end of the room, you'll need to trim off the tongue. The piped end of each panel should be positioned on the centre line of the joist or batten that forms one side of the access bay you've allocated, while the other end of the panel should either be trimmed so that it sits in the centre line of the relevant joist or batten, or if necessary, supported on a nogging or dwang. Fix all the laid panels to the joist or battens with wood screws or with annular ring shank nails. These should be 2.5 times the thickness of the panel. Insert the screws 25mm from the edge, and at 150mm intervals, making sure you avoid the red lines. We recommend 5 screws per board width, along the line of each joist or batten underneath. All the tongue and groove joints between panels should be glued, and any glue that dries proud of the board can be removed with a scraper later. Make sure you push the pipe tails down into the access bay. The notches you've made in the tops of the joists or battens should allow the pipes to sit down correctly into the space. Now we're going to connect up the panels. We do this firstly by creating headers of 16mm pipe. You do this by taking a Hep2O 16-16 10mm branch reduced T plus a piece of 16mm flexious pipe cut to length, equivalent to the distance between the tail of one panel and the equivalent tail of the next panel. This should be around 58cm. Insert a pipe support sleeve into the pipe end and connect the pipe into the T. Then add another T, followed by another length of pipe, and so on until you have the same number of T's as there are panels across the room, and one fewer length of pipe. Make sure you put a pipe support sleeve into each pipe end that is connected to a T. Create the second header in the same way. Now we're going to connect these headers to the pipe panels. The pipe tails will be sticking out into the open access bay between joists or battens. Remove the end caps from each of the tails and insert a pipe support sleeve into each. You may need to cut the tails to length in some cases. Next, on one side of the bay, identify all the equivalent pipe tails. That's the same tail from each of the panels on that side, and push these into the header. Now do the same for the other side of the bay with a second header. We now have two headers connected to the panels, one for each side of the bay. Next, we need to connect these two headers together. Get a small length of 16mm flexious pipe, insert a pipe support sleeve, connect it with a Hep2O 16mm elbow and attach it to one header, at the end furthest away from the flow and return route to the manifold. Repeat this for the other header, and then connect the two elbows together using a final short length of 16mm pipe with a pipe support sleeve inserted at each end, and push the completed connection down into the space between the joists or battens. Create two further headers as before. Attach these to the remaining pipe tails and connect the headers using elbows. Do this at the same end as for the first two headers. At the other end of the headers, there are now two remaining branch reduced T open connections for each connected header circuit. For one of the circuits, use a blanking peg and attach the other open end to the flow pipe from the manifold. For the other circuit, place a blanking peg in the corresponding open connection and connect the return pipe to the final open connection. With this entire assembly, you've now created a reverse return circuit. Just do a final check that the pipes are sitting in the notches you cut earlier, and that the pipe and fittings are sitting well in the access space between the joists or battens. When all the panels and pipework have been connected up, you can move on to the final installation stages, including pressure testing of the connected circuits, installation of the manifold and pipe connections to it, and balancing the system if it includes multiple circuits. Then comes wiring up the controls and enrolling the thermostats. All these stages will be explained in further installation videos. Once the circuit checks are complete, you need to fill the gap in the deck where you've created the pipe connections. Create an infill panel by cutting the tongue edge from a plain T&G panel, cut it to fit and screw it down. If you're interested in any of our other infloor systems, then look out for our other installation videos.